Off now for an opening statement, and then the ranking member, and then the committee chairman. If you want an American version of the running of the bulls, stand at the bottom of the steps after votes on a flyout day. We're all in a hurry to get home, and I am probably the worst culprit of all. A few weeks ago, a young boy and his sister were at the bottom of the steps waiting on me. Mr. Gowdy, do you have a minute? The young boy was 10, and his precious little sister was either 3 or 4. First time I asked her, she held up 3 fingers, and then she held up 4, so we kind of agreed on 3.5. I picked the little girl up and asked her brother what I could do to help him. And I didn't know if he wanted to talk about education. I didn't know if he wanted to talk about medical research or immigration. What he said was he wanted to pray for me, and that was all he wanted. He wanted to say a prayer. So I held his sister, and he said the most beautiful prayer at the foot of our Capitol. I think about that little boy and his sister from time to time, and I thought about him specifically over the weekend when my friend, the ranking member, sent me an article on people who are being persecuted in one country. And then a few hours later, I saw another article on a man in Central Africa whose throat was cut simply because he was a Christian. So we have the contrast between the greatness of this country, where even a young boy and his sister can petition their government at the foot of the Capitol, literally, waiting on their representative to practice the freedom of expression, the freedom of assembly, and the freedom of religious expression by openly praying in the shadow of the Capitol. And you contrast that with the reality that in other countries you face persecution for your beliefs. You may be put to death for the possession of a book that we swear all of our witnesses in on in court. You may be denied access to education because of gender. You may be persecuted or killed if your religious beliefs do not match the religious beliefs of the majority. You will be victimized, and the criminal justice system will be closed to you because you do not believe the right things or look the right way. Our fellow citizens recognize the gift we were given by being born in a land that values and practices religious freedom. And because we realize how fortunate we are compared to the plights of others, there is a tremendous generosity of spirit we feel towards those who were born into or live in oppression, discrimination, persecution, and retaliation. Americans are generous in spirit, and that generosity is evidenced by our willingness to help. But Americans expect that generosity will be respected and not abused. We expect those that seek to come here are honest and fair in their petitions. We know that there are survivors of inconceivable and heinous atrocities. We are outraged. We are sympathetic. And more than just sympathy, we are willing to open our country to provide those in need with a refuge, with a sanctuary, with safety and dignity. And about all we ask in return is that the system not be abused, and that generosity of spirit not be taken advantage of. So today we will examine how we can protect the integrity of our asylum program while ensuring we will not extend this special benefit to those who seek to take advantage, or worse yet, exploit American generosity to do us harm. With that, I would...